your garments and turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness. Repenteth him of the evil. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Dearly beloved brethren, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with a humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore, I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying after me. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred straight in the ways of the flesh. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done, and there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind, Christ Jesus, O Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, it hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent, and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Oh, A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. All the commandments which I command thee this day shall ye observe to do, that ye may live and multiply and go in and possess the land which the Lord sware unto your fathers. And thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness, to humble thee and to prove thee, to know what was in thine heart, whether thou wouldest keep his commandments or not. And he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger, and fed thee with manna, which thou knewest not, neither did thy fathers know, that he might make thee know that man doth not live by bread only, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord doth man live. Thy raiment waxed not old upon thee, neither did thy foot swell these 40 years. Thou shalt also consider in thine heart that as a man chasteneth his son, so the Lord thy God chasteneth thee. Therefore, thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways and to fear him. For the Lord thy God bringeth thee into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and depths that spring out of valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley and vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of oil, olive, and honey, a land wherein thou shalt eat bread without scarceness. Thou shalt not lack anything in it. A land whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills thou mayest dig brass. When thou hast eaten and art full, then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God for the good land which he hath given thee.
Thank you.
Reading from the Gospel according to St. Mark. And the disciples of John and of the Pharisees used to fast. And they come and they say unto him, Why do the disciples of John and of the Pharisees fast, but thy disciples fast not? And Jesus said unto them, Can the children of the bride chamber fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. But the days will come when the bridegroom shall be taken away from them, and then shall they fast in those days. No man also seweth a piece of new cloth on an old garment, else the new piece that filled it up taketh away from the old, and the rent is made worse. And no man putteth new wine into old bottles, else the new wine doth burst the bottles, and the wine is spilled, and the bottles will be marred. But new wine must be put into new bottles.
Thank you.
Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting.
Oh. seated. I don't think the gospel lesson for this evening is really about what it seems to be about. At first glance, the reading from Mark contained three things. It talked about fasting. It talked about patching cloth and pouring new wine in fresh bottles. Now, fasting seems appropriate enough for this, the first Sunday in Lent. For centuries now, this season has been associated with spiritual disciplines like fasting. Historically, that meant changing one's eating habits by restricting oneself to a simple meal once a day, usually in the late afternoon or early evening. The Jews of Jesus' time, the Roman Catholic Church, the reformers of Luther, Calvin, Wesley, and others all valued this spiritual practice. The hope is that going without food will let us see with fresh eyes how much we truly have. It should lead us to new hungers, fresh hungers, for justice, for sharing with others, for being more conscious about doing what is right whenever possible. But in the gospel lesson, Jesus was challenged for not fasting. Jesus answered his accusers with a wedding analogy, suggesting that this is a time of celebration, such as when a bride and a groom are finally united. The nearness of the kingdom of God meant that Jesus' disciples shouldn't fast, but instead they were to rejoice and be glad. They had known what it was like to be without, to be hungry, not only for food, but for righteousness. But now with Christ in their midst, it was a different season altogether. Now by the grace of God, they were to celebrate and to be glad. Now, after that brief section about fasting, the gospel then offers us two analogies about things old and things new. Old cloth, new patches, old wine bottles, new wine. Ministers love to pull out these verses whenever they're pushing for change. They announce that new wine is what is needed. And so, therefore, it's important to change the color of the carpet in the sanctuary. Or it's important to change the time of Sunday morning worship. Or pews should give way to chairs. Or liturgy with contemporary worship. Or organ music with praise bands. And at some point, the argument is made that all of these changes represent progress, the progress of new wine. A new way to evangelize, a new way to be God's people and to reach out into the world. And so as it is new wine, it requires new wineskins, new bottles to hold it. And why? Well, because the old ways of doing things are just that. They're old. They're fragile. They're not of much use. But again, that's not quite what's being said in the second part of the passage. One analogy spoke about an old cloak, but it is an old cloak that you still wish to use, which is why you're patching it in the first place. The old cloak, call it what you will, traditional worship, faith communities that care for one another sincerely during times of stress, being together in prayer and fellowship, all of that oldness has a lot going for it. If a foolish seamstress uses unshrunk cloth to patch this cloak, then later when it's washed, the patch will shrink and ruin the entire garment. Likewise, a thoughtless change in the life of a community of faith over time can damage the material, the internal fabric of the entire group, and only make things worse. New wine also needs room to expand. If it's simply poured into old wineskins, old containers, if it simply is dumped into existing church traditions and habits, potentially everything is disrupted. The seams split, the bottles break, the congregations divide. And the wine, the spirit, the vitality of the church is lost. But I'll repeat what I said earlier. I don't think this passage is really about what it looks like it's about. It's less about fasting and cloth and new wine. It has much more to say about intentions. It's scripture about clearly understanding what we're doing and being guided by our faith while we do it. About 60 years ago, the famous preacher Henry Emerson Fosdick addressed the congregation of Riverside Church in New York City as they were prepared to move into a soon-to-be-completed new Gothic cathedral. But he startled his congregation by saying these words, "My friends, it is not settled yet whether or not this new church will be wonderful. That all depends on what we do with it. If we should gather a selfish company there, though the walls bulged every Sunday with great crowds, that would not be wonderful. If we formed there a kind of religious club of the right kinds of people, and though we tripled our membership, that would not be wonderful. If we gathered in that heavenly place with all its beauty and praised ourselves for what we had built, that would not be wonderful. But if in this city, this glorious and wretched city where so many people live in unheavenly places, if because of this new heavenly place, we could go forth each week and lift some burdens, shed light in some dark spots, help some solve real problems, then this would be a wonderful place." Each of us starts with a given set of circumstances. We have our personal history, our church congregational history, our community history, and so forth. Only God creates ex nihilo. Only God starts from scratch. So given our situations, given our context, we are called to respond faithfully. On some level, the kingdom of God is already here. It is in our midst. And so as people who trust in the risen Christ and the redemption our Savior has won for all people, we usually do not fast. We don't usually wear downcast faces. And yet the fullness of God's realm awaits to be revealed. For in this world, we still know trial and tribulation. In this world, we have shooting deaths on our streets, weapon stockpiles in our homes and in armories, neighbors who lack basic medical care and food and shelter, and the litany of other deficiencies goes on, depleting the storehouse of the common good. And that's why at times, in truth, we do fast. We do sacrifice. We do recommit ourselves to do what is right for all, for the last, the least, the forgotten. The intent shapes whether we fast or not, and God is with us in both responses. Sometimes the old must be preserved, and so we look for the right material to patch our cloaks, the right words that established churches can use to communicate a message of hope to a hurting an alienated world. We look for the right settings, the right songs to sing, that to the Lord a praise of melody may be lifted. But sometimes the new requires new bottles and wineskins. Sometimes God's community here in Highland Park and East Liberty reminds us that what is sung to the Lord is a wide array of voices and even wider array of stories. And so at times, sometimes we pray in a language other than English. At times, sometimes we worship on days other than Sunday. At times we look beyond liturgy and tradition and try ministry that involves handouts and hand-ups, speaking out and speaking up, acting out and acting up. Because just about everything Jesus did was in some ways disruptive. And when is the last time we were like Jesus in this way? The past passages less about fasting and cloth and wine. And it's more about a version of the question that was asked by people long ago to Jesus, to us. Why do you do what you do? Lent is the perfect season to reflect on that question. Our prayers, may God provide you and us, and the church in these neighborhoods, and the church universal, the courage to ask and answer that very question with faithful hearts. Amen.
Lord be with you.
Let us pray.
Let us pray.
is in all the world. We commend this nation to thy merciful care, that being guided by thy providence, we may dwell secure in thy peace. Grant to the President of the United States, the Governor of this Commonwealth, and to all in authority, wisdom and strength to know and to do thy will. Fill them with the love of truth and righteousness. Make them ever mindful of their calling to serve this people in thy fear. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end. Amen.
Amen.
Mighty and everlasting God, who alone workest great marvels, send down upon our bishops and curates and all congregations committed to their charge the healthful spirit of thy grace, and that they may truly please thee, pour upon them the continual dew of thy blessing. Grant this award for the honor of our advocate and mediator, Jesus Christ. Amen. Mighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications unto thee, just promise that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all evermore. Amen.